Bill Johnson. How are you?
You're stronger than I am. I can't even see something in the ground.
This ground sure is hard.
It's been dry this week.
We probably need some rain, and that would heal. Of course, some of it's probably sign technique, too. Hello, Peggy.
Hey, it's probably that. Solid red clay under there.
That's solid pavement under there.
Yeah.
Solid Georgia clay.
I was going to say clay.
That clay.
Clay.
Yeah.
Rocks.
Success.
Good job.
I didn't do much. I wouldn't go in. It's so hard. It hurts my hand.
You know what? I also have some clips.
We'll try that.
If that doesn't work, we'll come back out again.
Well, this is, I left this for Nydia.
Oh, okay.
Thank you all. I know it's a late hour, but this is an important debate. We appreciate you staying. Please help me welcome our candidates for the District 2 Commission. We have Commissioner Brian Tan and Mr. Dennis Brown. Gentlemen, as with our last two debates, each candidate will have 2 minutes to introduce himself, state why you're running for office, and address some issues that are important to you. During the second phase of the debate, we'll have each candidate will have 1 minute to respond. His opponent will have 1 minute, and then we'll go back around robin. Closing statements will be a minute and a half for each candidate. So we'll start with Commissioner Brian Tan with his introduction.
Thank you. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
All right. Thank you for coming out this evening. Thank you for your interest in Forsyth County government. Mr. Underwood, thank you for your time in moderating this event. My name is Brian Tam, and I am running for re-election, County Commissioner of District 2, South Forsyth. My wife, Kelly, and I have lived in the county for 18 years. We have 3 children in Forsyth County Schools. As an incumbent, I'm running on my record. When I first ran for office 8 years ago, I was determined to be effective. Today, I'm pleased to say our county is sound financially with a reaffirmed bond rating of Moody's AAA. We have a balanced budget. We did not increase our millage rate last year. We don't plan to increase our millage rate this year. We have a stable tax digest. Education, recreation, public safety are the 3 reasons somebody chooses a community in which to live. In addition to being a county commissioner, I have sat on local school councils for 9 years. My partner in education programs have been recognized at the state level by the Georgia Association of Elementary School Principals, and I sit on the advisory board of North Georgia College and State University. To complement our school system, we have a great recreation system. I initiated Senior Center in South Forsyth, the Parks Recreation and Green Space Bond, recreation centers, and some 200 acres of green space in my district. respect to public safety, I co-chaired the 2003 SPLOST campaign that paid for our 911 communication systems, fire engines, road and intersection improvements. When I first came to office, I worked with our school system to place a sheriff's precinct next to South Forsyth High School where it would be the most visible. I have researched.
Fine.
Thank you.
Mr. Brown.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Dennis Brown. I'm running for commissioner in District 2, South Forsyth. I want to thank the Tea Party for their endorsement last night. I know there was a little controversy there, but I still got a solid 100% vote on that. So thanks to the Tea Party. I think the Tea Party stands for what Americans stand for, the true ideals. They're very patriotic, and I stand strong with the Tea Party. I want to thank my wife, Susie. She's been an employee of the Forsyth County school system for 12 years, and even though we don't have any children in the Forsyth County school system, Susie, please raise your hand or stand up. She's kind of shy, but she's best way for us to build a better city, county, or state government is to get rid of career politicians. I am not a politician. I don't want to be. I've never run for office. I'm a career soldier who has turned and decided to run to go serve. Some of the politicians are more concerned about winning the next election than they are serving the communities. And I would like to change that trend. Make no mistake, this election isn't about Dennis Brown or Mr. Tam. It's about the kind of government that you want to see. Next month, those who live in District 2 will choose between a career politician who's been in office for 8 years and looking for 12, and a public service who simply wants to make a public servant who simply wants to make a difference. And next month, they'll choose between a career politician who's done a great job of representing the city of Cumming, special interest groups, and big campaign contributors, and a public servant who will represent your interests. And also, you'll choose between a career politician who in 2010 voted for one of the largest tax increases in Forsyth County history. It did not pass.
Aye. Aye. Gentlemen, we'll be asking questions. As stated, each response, we have 1 minute. We'll begin with Mr. Tanner. Mr. Tam, what do you believe is the best way to facilitate infrastructure improvements in Forsyth County?
Best way to facilitate it, meaning the best way to pay for them?
You answered the question, sir.
Thank you. I think sales tax dollars are the best way to pay for them. We've proven that time and time again. As I said before, I co-chaired the SPLOST campaign in 2003, that was SPLOST 5. Infrastructure improvements that were paid for at that referendum were improvements to Minnesbury Road, improvements to Mathis Airport Road. When you collect sales tax dollars, you have people from outside of the county contributing to the pool of money. And you are able to not have to raise property taxes.
Mr. Brooks, what do you think is the best way to facilitate infrastructure improvements?
Well, I think you have to raise some taxes for sure, but I think it would be good to look at, instead of always taxing and spending, is look at ways that we can save money, build up a reserve, and then look at for other ways that we raise revenue other than just simply sales taxes. I heard one of the people I was out talking to about a cell tower, and their comment was, hey, there's some revenue for this, the county on the land or something. And someone said, well, we're not in the cell tower business. Well, I guess I look at if it's legal, if it's a source of revenue that we can use to keep from raising taxes, those would pay for infrastructure. And the other thing is, you know, this tax and spend progressive ideal, you know, we don't need to spend it every dime we make. Just because we have money doesn't mean we need to spend it right then. So I think a lot of it, obviously you have to have some taxes, but I think you need a good balance between how much you spend and how much you raise. It's always good to have a reserve for a rainy day.
I would just say that Forsyth County, particularly District 2 is the fastest growing district in the fastest growing county in the state of Georgia, really for the past 10 years.
and we need to stay ahead of the curve, so to speak, or some people might say caught up. But sales tax dollars have been able to fund a number of these projects, added to our public safety, not only with fire engines and 911 system improvements, but road and intersection improvements. And in doing so, we've been able to keep our property taxes, our millage rate, very, very low.
Mr. Pratt, you're about?
Yeah, just very quickly, even though our millage rate is among the lowest, it is the lowest in the 10 county metro area. If you include the total tax burden, which includes the loss, which three other counties don't have, we're third from the highest. So that's important to note, the total tax burden. And if T's lost, we'll get to that later. So we need to look at not just the millage rate, but the total tax burden that all of the citizens have to pay.
Mr. Brown, what criteria would you use to determine how to use the remaining green space bond funds? How they should be spent?
Well, I think the green space is primarily to do parks for the future service of the citizens. So I think we need to use the citizens in budget and see what they want to use the remaining funds. The point was made earlier, they didn't think there was any funds left, but if there are, I think citizen input, because they're the ones that use them, and it's their community that they live here, and we want to make it better. So I think a lot of times elected officials would go a long way simply asking their constituencies, what do they think? So that would be the primary one.
Mr. Payne?
Sure. When the Parks, Recreation, and Green Space bond first passed, I tried unsuccessfully to get the Trust for Public Land to moderate the process. It failed, and so we came back to commissioners deciding where green space money would go. I would support town hall meetings. I would support a real enhancement of our master plan for Parks and Recreation. We've been able to stay pretty well within that plan, but I think we need to, if we have extra funds, we're going to allocate those funds, we need to look to our master plan.
Mr. Brown, you're about to.
Good.
Mr. Tate, anything additional? Mr. Tam, what is Forsyth County's greatest need that you intend to address as a commission?
Our greatest need, first of all, is to live within our means and not raise our taxes. Also, transportation. I think we need to continue to build our master transportation plan. We have funding till 2019, identified through our most recent SPLOST referendum, and we need to get some of these transportation projects rolling. Also, it is incumbent upon us to keep our terrific quality of life. The Parks, Recreation, and Green Space Bond offers islands of really protected space in densely populated areas. We're about ready to open four of those parks in the next several weeks, and we need to look at continued preservation.
Mr. Brown, what do you believe is Forsyth County's greatest need, and how do you intend to address that situation?
I think our greatest need is managing the growth that's going to happen here in South Forsyth, especially. The whole county is going to grow, but South Forsyth is really under a lot of pressure. And to manage this growth, we're going to have to really watch these special interest groups, which have a control of the county right now. They're, a lot of times things are zoned not in the best interest of homeowners to protect your values, but it's based on donations, contributions to campaigns that influence the big money interests that are from outside Forsyth County. And I think the citizens deserve better than all of this money that's coming in. So managing this tremendous growth that we're under pressure to do is going to be very important, how we manage that. And when the economy comes back, it's going to be critical that we watch that.
Mr. Payne?
I would just say, with respect to special interest groups, my special interest groups are the homeowners in South Forsyth. And I've demonstrated that over and over again, and that's why I was reelected. I think that balanced growth with attracting quality commercial development, well-placed, such as projects on state highways or near the intersections of state highways, goes a long way, and we protect our residential communities.
Mr. Brett,
we're good.
Mr. Brett, how do you plan to balance the county's budget in light of declining revenues?
Well, one of the first things we do is we stop wasteful spending. A lot of times in the past, there's been things proposed like spending $700,000 for an ambulance for a private, a nonprofit agency. Although it's great, no one can argue with the needs out there. Taxpayer money is not the shouldn't be the primary source. We should look at donations and things like that. That was one of the ways that ultimately was purchased for the company. And it's the great causes, but the world's full of great causes. And I think the taxpayer has just about had all of the new taxes that we can handle. So we need to look at new ways to fund these things. They're all great causes. The world's full of great causes. But we see nationally $16 trillion worth of debt, and it starts right here in Forsyth County. Another example is the banking. Why would we spend $50,000 for banking services that we could have gotten free? It's just, you know, I'm no math major, but that's $50,000 we could put towards something else. So in austere times, you balance the budget by spending less.
Mr. Taylor, do you need to repeat the question?
I think the question was, how would we propose to balance the budget during this time? We have balanced the budget year after year. I think we've done so. We've eliminated positions, but probably the best way to balance the budget is to continue to encourage quality commercial development. I'll have to correct my opponent here. There was no ambulance proposed to be bought by the county. It was paid for, or is being paid for, with private funds, which I'm proud to have donated some of my own personal money to, because I think it's a worthwhile project for our county. As far as the banking services go, we didn't spend $50,000 for another banking service. They matched the price. So that's, we have been able to maintain a balanced budget year after year after year.
Mr. Brett, what about?
Well, I think Mr. Tannen is correct that that is how it's ultimately paid for, but they did propose it, and until it was reversed, that's how the way they were going to pay for it, if my facts are correct.
His facts are not correct.
Why are you a Republican, and which Republican principles do you most identify?
Well, I was born a Republican. That's why I'm a Republican. I embrace self-responsibility. I embrace self-accountability. I'm a small business owner. I make payroll every 2 weeks. I decide whether or not to take profits or reinvest them in the business. And I know that I will only fare as well as my community fares. Therefore, I try to give my time and efforts to the county in many different capacities, whether it's as a commissioner or as a partner in education or as serving on North Georgia's College and State University's advisory board. I think it's important to try to give back, make a difference, and help others get started.
Well, I think freedom, smaller government, patriotism, less taxes, the absolute minimum taxes should be imposed. If we take a dollar from a citizen, it should be well thought out, and it only is a last resort, because government at every level is bloated. It's out of control, so smaller government is key. And then freedom, both economic freedom and political freedom, accountability of government officials at every level, And I think that starts with term limits. And anytime you've been in more than 8 years, you can't fix the problem because you become the problem.
I see. Do I get to respond?
Yes.
Okay, well, we do have something called term limits, and it happens every time there's an election. And I drew my first term and put it before the voters with my record and was reelected. I would point out that, again, we are the fastest growing county in the state of Georgia, and stability in your local government is a good thing. There are a number of projects, a number of issues in play, and I think that having someone with some institutional knowledge of these projects, of these issues, is to your benefit.
Well, experience is good in some things like the medical profession, but with politicians, I don't think it's good because you can be a quick study and get up to speed on these projects very quick. If you have any managerial experience and leadership experience, I don't think it's not rocket science. It's having a good ethical foundation and being willing to make decisions, hard decisions, for the people and not for special interests.
Sewer infrastructure to serve the county, and if so, what do you plan to do so?
I think based on our development code and obviously the overlays, we do need to plan for that growth in advance so we're not caught up kind of the way we are with the traffic, for example, the new Walmart. So we do need to plan for that. And I think we have the SPLOST is going to pay for some of those. I think some of those projects are in there right now. We need to have a balanced approach to where once we zone something for that, we need to anticipate the water and sewer requirements, and that we do need to have that reserve. That's why we don't spend every penny we have. We have that reserve so that we can then quickly surge to meet the demand. But that's based on knowing what businesses are coming to the county and planning prudently for that, so it's not performed willy-nilly without any, much planning. And a lot of times we see a lot of zonings and things with.
Mr. Tanner, do you support this expansion of the water and sewer infrastructure to serve the county, and what are your plans to do?
Most definitely. First of all, there is not a water and sewer project on the most recent SPLOST other than the emergency raw water generator. There's no plans for SPLOST dollars to pay for any sewer lines. But they are needed, and they're needed particularly where there are private sewer plants. And while many of you do not know, there are, the county has bought some during my tenure, and when we buy them, they often cost us a lot of money. When there's a private sewer plant, the county is the trustee, which means if it fails, we have to take it over. And if we take it over, it's because it needs repairs, and if it needs repairs, we have to bring our checkbook. The best thing, the most important thing we have on our radar right now is the shake rag plant, and hopefully we'll get a decision on that by the end of the year. Shake rag and sewer plant.
Mr. Brown,
I'll just go on to the shake rag sewer plant. We'll be able to service the south end of the county. Mr. Brown doesn't know there's a private sewer plant in the old Atlanta Club. I attended a meeting there about 2 or 3 weeks ago, some 40 or 50 concerned citizens. That's their number one concern, because private sewer plants are allowed to charge more than the county sewer plants are. So their bill is higher for their sewer treatment. And the county doesn't have a whole lot of authority to regulate them. Therefore, if they have a smell issue or a fluid issue, there could be a problem. Shake rack plant will be able to remedy this.
Mr. Tanner, lead off this next question. Should growth be encouraged in Forsyth County? And if so, what type of growth should be encouraged?
Growth should be encouraged in Forsyth County. Quality growth should be encouraged in Forsyth County. Quality commercial growth should be encouraged in Forsyth County. First of all, I think companies such as New York Life that provide environmentally friendly, high-paying jobs are a great asset to our county. I think commercial development such as the Avenue Forsyth help generate significant taxes for our county. And I think children's health care in Forsyth County help provide a terrific service for a young bedroom community. Those are the types of businesses that we need. We're not out soliciting residential housing to come to Forsyth County. There is plenty of inventory. And we have stood strong on not giving in to our zoning requirements to compromise on that.
Mr. Brown, should growth be encouraged in Forsyth County? And if so, what type of growth?
I absolutely believe the county will grow. It should be encouraged. It shouldn't grow for growth's sake, though, or for special interests. It should be what the citizens want. It's like we talked about at the Smart Growth the other night. People don't need Forsyth County to live in Gwinnett County or Cobb or things like that. If they want that kind of place, they need to move to those places. And they moved to Forsyth County for a different quality of life and that is unique, and that's why we're the 13th fastest. And the commission has done a lot of good job in enforcing the Peachtree Parkway overlay, although there are a lot of variances that have been granted, some I've disagreed with. But we absolutely are going to grow. It just depends on how we manage it. And we need to make sure that we use the citizens' input primarily because, again, the special interest money, once it's out there, it's everywhere you look, and the next thing you know, things are zoned a certain way, and the people are going, you know, what happened?
Mr. Tatton, you're about.
The special interest that Mr. Brown is talking about are, again, the homeowners in South Forsyth. I have a broad-based constituency, a number of them own businesses, a number of them have lived there for a number of years, and, you know, they have contributed to my campaign. As I mentioned earlier, education, recreation, public safety are the reasons people want to come to a community. So with respect to residential housing, as long as we keep those things strong, there'll be a demand for the residential housing. People want to move here. And we are fortunate that we have, you know, some sustained growth using up our existing inventory with our residential lots of arguments up.
Mr. Brown, any rebuttal?
Well, no, the only thing I'll say is, you know, you look around, you don't want to repeat mistakes that other counties have made. And one of the main things you do is you look at other counties. And right now, when they have three commissioners are going to jail because of special interest and money that went there. So the only thing I'm saying is, you know, if it looks like a duck and it quacks, you know, it's out there. Everybody knows it. It's an 800-pound, you know, gorilla in the room, and maybe everything's like it's supposed to be. But I do know that special interest. You hear about it every day, and a lot of the people are just shaking their head that they've almost got turned off to government because of some of the things they see. They're frustrated. They're tired of it at every level. And people are too fed up with it, and I think they're ready for a change.
Mr. Brown, does Forsyth County need more parks? If so, what type?
We have some. We probably have the world-class park system. There's no doubt, and they're wonderful parks. They're great for the citizens. The only thing is, you know, is how we pay for them. And I don't, you know, even going back to the green space and things, I don't mind buying green space. But we don't need to pay 4 or 5 times what the property's worth to, in the buying market, you know, we can get land a lot cheaper than we have done in the last few years. We paid a premium for land in a declining market, and the real estate people are telling me, like, what is going on here? You know, why are they paying this extra money for this land? And so I'm no real estate expert. A lot of this, when it happened, I was in Afghanistan, so I didn't hear a lot about it. But you just hear, you're out talking to potential voters, and they tell you these things. So and then they show me the facts. So I guess that's where I get a lot of my facts, and then out of the newspapers too. So,
all right, Mr. Taylor.
With respect to the question, do we need more parks? Well, we have some property that we already own that needs to be developed, particularly in North Martin County for active recreation. We still have, people having to play their sports 9 o'clock in the evening, some of these games start. So we do need some more rectangular fields. With respect to paying too much money for green space, every piece of property the county bought, we bought for appraised value or less. That's not paying too much money when you buy things for appraised value or less. What we wouldn't buy, or what I wouldn't go for to buy, was to pay more than the appraised value for their golf course. I gladly would have supported it had it been for appraised value, but once it got way outside of the box, I just couldn't go along
with it. Mr. Brett, you're about it.
Well, you know, I guess the appraisal, it's all in the appraisal. I guess it depends on any grades of lumber, but in all accounts that I've seen, read about, we did overpay for the land, and we could have gotten it at a substantially lower cost. At least that's what my sources tell me.
Okay, your sources are wrong. We paid appraised value or less, plain and simple. Check it yourself for their public record for the green space parks that we bought. They add to people's property values. When you put recreation into densely populated areas, it helps people's property values increase. That's one of the reasons why our tax digest has remained so stable.
Mr. Tennant, what's your vision for Forsyth County in 20 years, and what do you plan to do with the vision to achieve that goal?
Well, actually, I think it started 8 years ago. But what I will see in Forsyth County, first of all, is with respect to transportation, I'd like to see better interconnectivity. We have activities at Lambert High School. Soon people will be able to walk to those activities. So soon there'll be more and more sidewalks for kids to be able to walk to school. They won't have to be dropped off. They won't have to drive themselves. I see a community that is rich in high quality jobs, children's health care expanding, North Georgia College and State University expanding in Forsyth County, Lanier Technical College, and actually our school system almost serving as a feeder program for some of these technical college and universities.
What's your vision for Forsyth County in 20 years, and what do you plan to do as a commissioner to achieve that vision?
My vision for Forsyth County, the reason I moved here, is I want it to be the best county nationally and globally, and I think we have the potential to do that. And as commissioner, I would go out and get not just retail jobs, construction jobs, those just come with the territory. We could be like another Silicon Valley. We have the best schools, we have a great school system. One of the things we talked about at Smart Growth was that quality employers, Fortune 500, Silicon Valley type jobs, they're looking for quality schools, quality of life, and low taxes, all the things that Forsyth County offers. And we're at a junction right now. And I think if we continue to build quality parks and things like we're doing, those are all good, but you know, we, at the end of the day, we have to pay for them. And we've raised taxes and we've raised taxes, and with this T-SPLOST that we make 8%, and then, I don't know if we'll get into that, but then,
Mr. Campbell,
No.
Mr. Brown? Brown, what would you do to improve working relations with the city of Cumberland?
That's an easy one. I think I would first of all go sit down with them as a group as much as possible. Make it open to the public. You know, I had never met with Mayor Ford Brown. I went and met with him about a month ago, and we sat down and had a very cordial discussion. And he told me, and I have his quote here, I have a stack of them, but he told me that there had never been a good faith attempt, a good faith discussion from this board over here. Mayor Gravitt's done an excellent job of representing the city of Cumberland. I just don't think this board has done a good job of representing the citizens of the county. I think it's just common sense. People normally, if you just make a good faith effort and go sit down with them and you talk, you usually get a good result. But you can't wait until the last minute on a 25 year project and wait till the last minute and expect a good outcome. And that's what we've done. We've kicked the can down the road and all of a sudden time ran out.
Mr. Tan, what would you do to improve the working relationship with the city of Cumberland?
Well, first of all, since taking office, I have tried to meet with the mayor every week or two, just to keep the lines of communication open. Sometimes we talk about county issues, sometimes we talk about his grandchildren. Sometimes those meetings go well, sometimes they don't. But I will say this, that the most recent SPLOST referendum that was passed was unanimous with the Board of Commissioners. It was unanimous with the mayor and city council. It was unanimous with every local elected official. With respect to the water contract, we had to rule out every other option, which we did. There was a long time here when this board was going to go down the reservoir path. We were going to get in with the Blades. We were going to Lumpkin County. We were going to Dawson County. And we didn't. Came down to price and quantity because we knew that was the best place for us to get the water unanimously as a board.
Right. Brett?
Well, you know, the thing about negotiations is it seems like on the water and some other issues too that they go back and they start at zero every time instead of a cumulative effect. Some leadership on the board regrouping and saying, okay, let's go back. Don't back up. Let's go back and take the gains that we've made and negotiate something that we can all live for. You know, a citizen of Forsyth County includes the city of Cumberland. I don't know why we have two different groups and it's been going on for years, but you know, with some leadership, I think that can be solved. I really do. I think with good faith, effort, and working at it, not just playing politics as usual, I think people are tired of it. They're tired of hearing about it. They're tired of reading about it. And we're almost the laughing stock of the state in some ways, for that matter. So I just think it's basic leadership.
Mr. Taylor, you're about it.
Certainly. The most recent water contract that we signed takes our finished water price down to $2.25 a gallon, which is the same price that we paid from Fulton County. When we did a rate survey out of 24 different water customers, we were number 9. Which means 13 other customers were paying more, other governments were paying more than we were paying. The water contract that was in place for 25 years required us to buy a certain amount of money from the city of Cumberland, a certain kind of amount of water, excuse me. But it also required them to provide it to us. Nobody's walking around the county complaining about not being able to take a shower anymore. We've had water. We extended the contract pretty much the same because it has withstood the test of time. And we got a better price for the finished water.
Mr. Tam will be leading off our next question.
Can I have one?
No, sir. Mr. Tam, will the success or failure of T-SPLOST impact how you address precise transportation needs?
Well, it has to a certain degree because some of the projects require attention from both lists. First of all, let me say this about the T-SPLOST. Until I'm not comfortable with the priority, nor am I comfortable that we're going to miss out on funds we would have gotten anyway. And until those two questions are answered, I can't sit here and support it. I think we need to just plan on our own, being self-reliant. The nice thing about our SPLOST is we get to keep all of our money here. I don't believe my opponents supported the most recent SPLOST and called for road improvements to Old Atlanta Road, intersection improvements, that called for a library expansion, that calls for a sidewalk system throughout the county. Maybe you can speak to that.
Mr. Brown, will the success or failure of T-SPLOST impact how you address precise transportation needs?
I think it'll definitely impact it, because if we pass the 1% SPLOST, T-SPLOST, that will result in a 14% increase in our taxes we pay. It's a 10-year tax, it's the largest tax increase in Georgia history. It will quadruple the Georgia DOT budget, and it's given money to an agency that's already proven they can't manage it, and it's given them a lot more money. So I think that's good. Mostly what that does, it prevents it. So if we have an 8% tax, then when we need, and the projections that this T-SPLOST is based upon are very, very favorable. I mean, they're the optimal projections in the billions, just like Bill mentioned. And it will leave us short locally with funds to finish out the project. So absolutely, if T-SPLOST passes, it will greatly diminish our ability to raise additional funds for local projects, which we sorely need at the expense of MARTA and other things statewide.
Mr. Tate, any rebuttal?
No.
Mr. Brown, anything additional? Mr. Brown, what experience do you have that qualifies you to serve as a commissioner?
How long do I have to talk about that? Well, it is true. I've never been in politics. I've never been in an elected office before. I spent 3 years in the military, most recently doing projects, civil infrastructure, rule of law projects in Afghanistan, and working with the Corps of Engineers, multinational agencies in a prohibitive, hostile environment. That's the latest one. And then throughout my career, I've had lots of complex leadership challenges dealing with government agencies at every level, working for the Homeland Security Office, interfacing with GEMA, FEMA, all those agencies, the Incident Command System, in very complex and asymmetrical environments that are very much similar to what you see at the local level. So even though I haven't been a politician, I've worked around a lot of them. I've had to write rules and regulations for them.
Prior to being elected to Forsyth County Board of Commissioners, I served on the Board of Directors for the Forsyth County Chamber of Commerce, and I co-chaired the SPLOST campaign back in 2003. I also sit on local school councils, as I mentioned, and I have 8 years' experience sitting on Board of Commissioners. State Attorney General Sam Rowland says, "I have the courage, values, experience, and determination to preserve our high quality of life, that I'm committed to open and transparent government, and I have set a high standard of service and dedication for my fellow commissioners across the state of Georgia." State Attorney General Sam Rowland. He is not endorsing any other candidate. He is not endorsing any other commissioner.
And you're about?
Well, I'm sure I have a lot of respect for Mr. Owens and for Mr. Tan and their service. I really do. However, the voters will decide, not these endorsements from afar, because often their motivation for endorsing is not based on local needs, but it's based on state needs and politics. I have a great deal of respect for all of them. I think just after, I believe in term limits, and then after a while, it's time for some new ideas, fresh ideas, and let other quality people stand up and make a difference in the county.
just point out that prior to being our state attorney general, Sam Owens was a commissioner in Cobb County, so he knows what it takes to do this job. I would also like to say that as far as politics go, I don't view this job as politics. I don't write on blogs. I just try to stick to the facts. I try to include the community. I try to bring about just a level-headed, common-sense approach to these issues and let everyone be subjected to the process that this government should provide.
Thank you, Mr. Tim. Our next question. Have you identified any areas of county government to be made more efficient? And if so, what are they? And what do you intend to do in your term as commissioner? Yes, sir.
Well, you know, I remember the day we let 26 people go out of planning and zoning. And we have trimmed our budget by millions of dollars. We're going to have around 1,200 building permits come into the county this year. I don't think we need to be cutting our levels of service right now. I think, though, that in the first 4 years I was on the Board of Commissioners, we had three county managers. Now we've had a county manager for the past 3 years, and we have stability in that department. There's stability, we have a terrific staff, and we have a terrific financial group, and our county manager has terrific support. Our legal system, our legal counsel is asked to participate in issues at the state level.
Mr. Brown, have you identified any areas of county government that can be made more efficient? And if so, what are they, and what do you intend to do to accomplish that?
In my travels, I've listened a lot, and some of them say that we can possibly outsource some things like IT that could be done more efficiently by private agencies. That would merit, I think, closer look. One of the things that I've always learned to do is to listen to the people that do the job every day and they know it best. And so I think there's probably, I've never seen a government agency where there weren't some efficiencies that could be had and things could be done better and streamlined. So I think one of the first things I would do is just ask every agency to have some meetings with their employees and listen to them and see where the people, where the ground meets, the rubber meets the road. A lot of times they have some of the best suggestions and they can make recommendations where we could cut things. We can streamline a lot of the processes that go on here, just like with the building permits, et cetera, and reduce government burden and paperwork wherever possible. And then, listen to the people.
Mr. Kane, you're right.
No, only to compliment our staff once again. And looking at the stability that we have in these departments and the services that they're able to provide. You know, I get emails, and most of them these days are pretty complimentary. But I can tell you, several years ago, they weren't.
Mr. Brown, anything additional? All right, last question, gentlemen. Mr. Brown, what can be done to improve transportation?
One of the things, I used to drive to Marietta every day, and one of the things, you're sitting there at a four-way and everybody's looking at each other and no one's moving. So I think traffic engineering could vastly improve synchronization of traffic lights, automated, so that people aren't sitting in traffic lights for a long time. I know we talked about that. Not just like we talked about the other day, building more lanes and making it wider and just build it. We see how that works, and if you still have gridlock on 285 and in other counties, building more doesn't always work, so we have to have better traffic engineering, look at other ways, and I think roundabouts work in some cases. Some cases they don't, but we need to look at the full range of options and best practices in other places where they have dealt successfully with a traffic problem to do that. That's just a couple of things that I would recommend.
Mr.
Taylor?
Well, first of all, I'd just like to say, you know, it's not only Forsyth County, but it's working with our Department of Transportation. When you simple things like intersection improvements, will go a long, long way. And we've had a number of them take place in our county. In fact, if you just look at James Burgess, or if you look at Nichols Road, or if you look at Brookwood Road, where it hits 141, Brookwood Road hitting 141, you know, that was a project we needed to give the DOT on and ask them just to add a, let us put in a right turn line. Makes all the difference in the world. The other thing we're headed towards, I think, is interconnectivity. We're the second healthiest county in Georgia. Why not be the first? What we need is to continue to improve our sidewalk system. It's not just for kids. Why can't we walk to the grocery store? A number of people do it, you know, if you had a sidewalk system. I think that that's very important. Thank you.
Ms. Brown.
No, I agree. I walked to McDonald's this morning, got a cup of coffee, and that's an exercise there. So, you know, sidewalks are good, and transportation is one of those issues a lot that's closely parallel with growth. It's going to have to be managed, but it needs to be planned out, and it needs to be based on, you know, long-term growth plans instead of these, some of these willy-nilly zonings that we've had with shopping centers that have never been occupied and, you know, sit vacant for 7 years. And again, just how many nail places do you need?
All right, gentlemen. Well,
I was just going to say, I'm not in favor of any more nail places, but it's not the government's job to tell people what kind of business they can open in a strip center. I'll try to get this in 1 minute, but I'm reminded of somebody who said, do not let the Walgreens go in or the CVS go in down our corridor because the efforts failed down the road. Well, the fact of the matter is, Walgreens and CVS has a better business plan than Eckerd. And they're alive and thriving, although the Eckerd is out of business. It's not for the government to say, who's got a good business model, who doesn't? Who's a McDonald's, and who's a Jack in the Box?
Thank you. Well, gentlemen, we got to the last phase of our debate tonight. We'll lead off with Commissioner Tan, if you make the closing statements. A minute and a half.
A minute and a half. Thank you very much. First of all, I'd like to thank all of you for staying out this late at night. I would just like to tell you that when I ran for office, I said I would do three things. I said I would help balance the tax digest, and I'm still committed to do so. I said I would help deliver capital projects, and I'm still committed to do so. McGinnis Ferry Road, Old Atlanta Road, Mathis Airport. Most importantly, I said I would involve the community. We had a chance to save a lot of money on Mathis Airport Road. Some of you might remember, it was called the S alignment. Unfortunately, it took that road right through some people's backyards. Couldn't do it. There's a price you pay for development and reducing somebody else's property values. And in South Forsyth, over the past 8 years, that has been my goal, is to try to strike a balance with the growth that we have because we're such an attractive place to live. We're causing our own problem because we have great schools, great recreation, and great public safety, and it creates a demand for people to want to come live here. And so therefore, you need a representative that's going to include everyone at the table and sit down and hammer these issues out. And over the past, thank you.
Well, I think Mr. Tan is exactly right. This growth is going to have to be managed, and it's going to take some a lot of work to do that. I will be a full-time commissioner if I can be elected to this. Next month, we have an opportunity to take this county government back from the city of Cumberland, because right now I feel like the tail is wagging the dog.
Yeah.
Special interest groups and big money campaign contributors do run this county, make no mistake about it, north, south, east, and west.
Yeah.
So So the big thing here is you do have a choice this election. I think it's clear there's a lot of differences between the two candidates, a lot of similarities too, but you do have a choice. And I think just as we see in a lot of government agencies and things, after a while you just see it's time for a different voice, a different way of doing things, and I think we've arrived at that. We don't need more taxes, we need more efficiency in our government, and we need to build up a reserve for our county so when the lean times come, because we don't know what's coming around the corner here. So I would humbly ask for your vote and for your support and your prayers. Please visit votedbrown.com. I think I'm very passionate about everything I do. I'm very patriotic, and I love this country and the county. Just like Tim says, I'm honored to be your commissioner.
Thank you, Jordan. This has been very enjoyable. Thank you all for coming. I know it's way past dinner time, but we'll look forward to seeing you tomorrow night at 6:30, same room. We're having our sheriff report. Good night.
Dennis Brown for Commissioner District 2. Go to www.votedbrown.com. If the webpage doesn't answer your questions, call me 678-557-9844 and I will clarify. Thank you very much.
Nydia, good night.
Good night.
Good night.
I'm not endorsing him. I'm just holding the overlay. Hey, see, you did great. Yeah. Yeah, man.
Thanks, guys. Thank you for all your support and love.
If I didn't live on a dead-end street that only had a dozen houses, I'd need a sign this big.